Let's just give it a couple of seconds. Hey, and we're live.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to the On the Pause session, where we're going to be talking about nursing schools of the future. On behalf of the Johns Hopkins School of Nursing, we'd like to thank you for joining us today to talk about where and how nursing education will take place in the future. We are very excited to be at the completion stage of our new state-of-the-art 41,000 square foot addition to our School of Nursing that we worked with in partnership with Hord, Coplan, Macht. Today on Twitter, when I was getting ready for this session, I saw a tweet from a student who said, "I've just walked into the building and it's absolutely beautiful." And that's the exhilaration and feel I have when I walk into this amazing new space. But when we planned our building, the world was very different. And it would be an understatement to say that COVID-19 has not turned everything upside down. It's identified many challenges, but also opportunities. And universities and schools of nursing around the world have had to pivot very quickly to meet the changing new environment, and in particular, the digital environment. So each and every one of you listening today will be having the same thoughts we are, I'm sure, and asking the same questions, which are, you know, how can we thoughtfully, intentionally, and from a data-driven perspective, prepare for what our new world is going to be like? So today, I'm very excited to have a conversation with our colleagues from the University of Washington, Columbia University, Hord, Coplan, Macht, the architects that orchestrated our building. And I'm also very honored that my co-host for today is Emeril Jenkins. So I'm just going to briefly introduce the panelists so we can have as much time as possible for discussion. So it's my pleasure to welcome Jennifer Dotzenrod, who is the Associate Dean for Enrollment Management and Student Affairs at the Johns Hopkins School of Nursing. And she has shepherded us through a very challenging time and been able to maintain our robust student enrollments and also learn to work and communicate with students in an increasing digital world. Kristen Brown is an assistant professor and the advanced practice simulation coordinator at the Johns Hopkins School of Nursing. Dr. Brown has done so much to help us innovate in our clinical practice education, but today she's going to share with you some of her innovations, including the use of virtual reality, particularly in advanced practice. We're also so excited that we have Dr. Judy Honig, who is the professor and vice dean at Columbia University, to join us today. And like many of you, I looked at her amazing new building with envy over recent years, and now we're excited to have our own. And so I think it'll be great to have a perspective, particularly from a very urban campus, about what the new world will look like. And also, it's my pleasure to welcome Anne Hirsch, who's the Associate Dean for Academic Affairs at the University of Washington. And last but not least, we have Paul Lund is a principal in the Hord Coplan Macht Education Studio. Paul is really embedded in university design and innovation, and he's been actively involved in developing nursing schools for the future. I've mentioned here at Johns Hopkins University, but also at the University of Maryland, the University of Virginia, and Georgetown University. And he has a passion for buildings that just don't meet programmatic goals, but create strong and vibrant communities for students, faculty, and researchers. So to kick us off today, I'm going to hand over to my co-host, Emeril Jenkins, who is enrolled in our DMP PhD program and studies older adults with cognitive impairment. And Emeril, not only is she a stellar scholar and nurse practitioner, but she has been a passionate advocate for diversity, equity, and inclusion in our school. And for that, I'm very grateful. So over to you, Emerald.
Thank you, Trish, for that lovely introduction. I would also like to thank Dr. Janice Taylor, who is my PhD advisor, and Dr. Valerie Carter, my DNP advisor, for their continued support on my journey. I'm truly excited to be here with you all, and I look forward to this discussion around nursing schools of the future. So I want to get right in there. I want to ask a general question of everyone individually here. How do you feel the pandemic has impacted learning, building, designing, et cetera? Let's start with Dr. Dotzenrod.
Thank you, Emerald. Emerald should also mention she was one of our master's entry students as well. So she has been at our school for a long time, and we are going to miss her very much if she ever leaves. I hope you don't. That's just a sigh. But we have found very much that it's been an interesting mix. So as with everyone, when we went online, there were students who welcomed it. They really had enjoyed the online learning. They enjoyed not having to fight traffic to get into a urban school. But many of our students really missed the interaction. I think nursing students at all levels are very much wanting to engage with each other, with faculty, with staff, and with patients. And so it has been a struggle for students at that time. And so learning has taken on a variety of different things. We at the School of Nursing have really looked at ways to engage students, both through clubs and organizations, looking at the types of work that is done in the classroom, how to engage students, how better to work with them, how to be open to all the different learning styles that maybe students and faculty had not addressed when we weren't an all online school. And I would say that it has certainly impacted. I think we also are very much looking forward to getting back to our new large building, but I think we will look at space and we will look at all of the aspects of space very differently now and moving forward, whether that's in the classroom, whether that's students studying together. And I think we will have a much larger mix of people both on campus and off campus that are finding that balance for themselves.
Thank you, Dr. Dotzenrod. And now Dr. Brown.
Hi, thank you, Emerald. It's good to see you. And thank you, Dean Davidson, for hosting this event. So, you know, for me as a STEM educator and someone that loves immersive learning, you know, it was a push, and I think in the right direction for us as a whole. You know, we were heading into a space prior to COVID that we had to think outside the box of how we're going to educate and how we're going to provide immersive learning opportunities for our students. And I always like to say, if the immersive learning opportunity doesn't change their behavior, then it's not worth it. So I think there's a lot of tools out there. There's a lot of commercial products. There's a lot of kind of educational support. But if you use it just to check a box and it doesn't change someone's behavior, you didn't do it the right way. So I think for us, we really had to, you know, we had a plan to implement a virtual simulation, whether it's screen-based or virtual reality, prior to COVID. But with the push of COVID, we had to take really our 4-year plan and turn it into a 3-month plan and really start to roll it out. And for us, we did it in a way that we had curricular integration, and we did it by simulation standards of best practice. So it wasn't just a product that we just put in to check a box. We did it in a way that made sense. And so I think for us, it was really a push in the right direction to show, you know, we can provide immersive learning opportunities from afar. We've used telepresence robots for quite some time. We have our distance learners come into educational situations, whether it's simulation or coming into a classroom where they're all over the country. And it allows our students that are working as nurses to come back to be a nurse practitioner and not be on site. In our advanced practice program, we were online. We've already had this digital transformation. So this was something that we had kind of prepared for, but now it was just taking that those immersive opportunities and really kind of trying some new things. And I think it's so far it's been really successful.
Thank you, Dr. Brown. Dr. Honig, your response, and just as a reminder, the question is, how do you feel the pandemic has impacted learning, building design, et cetera?
Well, it's an understatement to say that it affected it. And I really almost don't know where to start, but I will start with how it affected our teaching, because I think that was in the same way it accelerated some virtual reality, a virtual simulation for students, it really pushed the faculty to be thinking in a direction that we might have been going, but very slowly. We were very complacent in our on-ground classes and being innovative in a face-to-face situation. And now we had to think about being innovative in a remote situation. So first we had to get comfortable with remote, and it wasn't only the teachers that needed to get comfortable. We also needed the students to get comfortable, because our students come to Columbia anticipating to be sitting in a chair next to their classmates and in front of, and have the teacher, you know, in present with them. So it was a very steep learning curve. We were the epicenter of the pandemic right at the very beginning. So we kind of didn't have anywhere to look for guidance where other people might have been successful. So we just muddled forward. I would say key words are uncertainty, urgency, making decisions without enough data, with limited data, and then making decisions based on that had to get changed because the data changed and the recommendations changed. So being facile and resilient and adaptive, very, very key. And that goes across staff, faculty, and students. Like, we all had to be in this together, otherwise it wouldn't be successful. And I would say that we were. The other important, I really wasn't thinking in terms of space, because our building was off limits. We weren't allowed in our building for the first beginning of the pandemic. But a little bit later, I guess in the summer, we put together a protocol that permitted our students to engage in simulation, in person, in simulation with all the public health protocols in place. And fortunately for us, we are in a beautiful new building that dedicates 2 of 7 floors to simulation. So it's a considerable amount of space. I don't know what the size of the footprint is, but it's big. A lot of space. And so in that way, we were very, very fortunate to be in our building at this time. On the flip side, our building is a very open environment, which is not going to be good when we reimagine how we're going to be coming back into the building, because there aren't the protections of distancing and walls to maintain good public health distance from our colleagues. So I would say urgency, uncertainty, making decisions in the absence or with little data were really driving us and continue to drive us. And the other piece that I think is important, and it hasn't been mentioned yet, is the importance of having academic practice partnerships, because clinical was severely affected. The very beginning of March, all of clinical at Columbia was suspended for students, and so they couldn't go. And we were able to work very closely with our partners to re-engage clinical in innovative ways, and I'm sure they'll come out in our discussion.
Thank you, Dr. Honig. Dr. Hirsch, what do you think?
Well, I can certainly, and thank you for having me today from the West Coast. We weren't necessarily the epicenter from the beginning, but we were the beginning. And so I can certainly relate, and Judy and I connect on a regular basis about how is this working and what are best practices. So I appreciate that opportunity. Not only did we have to change and deal with uncertainty, the technology and the delivery, there was some content that needed to be changed as well. There was a new emphasis on social determinants of health, interprofessional education. So that's what I want to bring back to the building. We did break ground on a new building Health Sciences Education Building, totally devoted to health sciences education, in August, so right in the middle of everything. And that building was meant to achieve two major goals: incorporating state-of-the-art teaching technology. So we were already on that pathway to upgrade and enhance the way we use technology and facilitate interprofessional education. So fully embracing that new technology and interprofessional education really requires some purposeful planning for buildings. So I'm leading into that, where the project goals were to create a health sciences education building with flexible spaces, modern technology, and a broad array of environments that adapt to the changing pedagogical needs of the health sciences, because what we know is it's going to keep changing, but enable active and team-based learning. So that hub, I really relate to the need for students to have that time together outside of class too. So that hub for the health sciences education and training must foster interaction, collaboration, and creativity for students in and outside of the learning spaces.
Thank you so much, Dr. Hirsch, for your response. And now, Dr. Lund, what do you think?
Well, as the architect, and I'm not a doctor, I will talk a little bit about the space itself. I mean, obviously, I was in a position when the pandemic hit. I had just attended a simulation conference in San Diego right before everything broke loose. And of course, having worked with numerous clients, I had heard a lot of anecdotes from the different nursing schools and how they were adapting. But I'd say a lot of folks, you know, that just answered the questions, my esteemed colleagues, you know, really hit it on the head. It was this idea of how can you create flexible space that's safe? If your building was newer, you know, you could start to look at MERV 13 and 14 filtration of air or opening of windows. There was a renewed interest in outdoor learning and outdoor space. And Hopkins is fortunate enough to have a courtyard right outside the school. And these ideas of flexible classrooms that were already being integrated into the project here were really part of that whole process of moving the pedagogy of Hopkins forward, but also really moving the pedagogy of nursing. So we took auditoriums and they became more flat floor. What we heard is all of those spaces that were very flexible functioned really, really well, whether it was an OSCE suite that we did or a classroom space or even just a big open area like the new hub that will be opened eventually to people at your school. But I think what was lost was the sense of belonging of the students. How do the students connect outside the classroom? And those are the spaces that I think we as architects are trying to create for these, all these nursing schools, is that sense of belonging, you know, the long hours that are put in by faculty, researchers, students. You need those restorative spaces and those social spaces. So that's what I heard from the pandemic.
Well, Paul, that's a really good segue into a question that's come to us about telehealth and the role of schools of nursing in preparing students for a future with telehealth, which has been really an exciting progress during the pandemic. We feel like we've been talking about it for decades, but now we're actually doing it. So I'd be interested to hear about how schools are adopting to the use of telehealth, and if there are any specific things that we should be thinking about in the physical environment, but also drawing your thread from Paul about can we create thoughtful and meaningful digital environments of connection, which is part of what the therapeutic interaction is with telehealth. So just going to open it up and please, any of the panelists want to sort of share their experiences with telehealth?
I'd be happy to talk about how telehealth and the way that it has transformed that what used to be kind of a niche application to really a preferred solution for many patients. So it behooves us to prepare our students to move into a healthcare environment where they have telehealth capabilities. So we've included that as content in the curriculum, especially for advanced practice, but we're also doing it with the undergraduate students. It's so helpful for people in remote areas and for people who have transportation issues or mobility issues. It's going to be the way of the future. The pandemic has only accelerated the development of those effective and efficient means of conducting telehealth sessions. So adding that content into the curriculum has been absolutely crucial.
Thanks. I'm going to concur with Anne, but it was never really a high priority in an urban area because we don't have remote patients. It's, you know, this public transportation, it's not hard to get somewhere unless you're homebound. And the homebound have another set of issues, and that is they tend to be the elderly and they tend not to have the resources to be able to log into a telehealth visit. So, but the pandemic, like other things, it just accelerated the use of telehealth, and now it's very standard operating procedure in many of our practices, and probably will last way beyond the pandemic. So yes, we are incorporating it into our curriculum. It hadn't been before. We don't even have, and I'm supposing that our simulation center is thinking about it, but we don't even have a simulation telehealth situation. Our students learned it through working with a faculty member or a preceptor delivering care via telehealth, or being a patient receiving care via telehealth. But it will be part of the curriculum going forward, and I think we will need some kind of a simulation of that kind of a visit. It is approved by the for a portion of the advanced practice education that clinical can be in this format, not exclusively, but it can be in this format. So we have to train some faculty on it as well.
Judy, that's an excellent point. I spoke with a student the other day who was reflecting on their telehealth experience with a faculty. And she said, you know, as soon as they couldn't have the camera on because of bandwidth. But she was amazed that the faculty member could pick up cues from the patient's voice. The patient said, how are you? And she said, I'm well. And then the clinician knew that she wasn't well. Yeah. So I'm really interested in, and Kristen, you're a simulation expert. Think about, you know, what are some of the modalities that we can use to develop this expertise? You know, you've used a lot of virtual reality. You know, how can we transport students into people's homes or, you know, a rural area to really appreciate a different environment?
Yeah, and you, Dr. D. Davidson, you bring up a great point. And I think, and to echo what my colleagues have said, you know, it's been in our curriculum, but I think obviously with the pandemic, it's now really here to stay. And if any of us have used it over this course of time, we know that, yeah, this is where it's heading and we're going to continue to use it. We did have to pivot quickly to, we took our standardized patient interactions, and for our higher level advanced practice students, we rewrote the cases to be telehealth cases. And so we looked at the telehealth competencies and made sure that it aligned with that. And then we gave them the experience, and then they had the faculty feedback, because how do you interact with a patient that you can't listen to their heart? You don't have, no matter what, you know, where you are or whatever, or telepresence rooms or whatever you have, no one has a stethoscope that's attached to their computer at home, and we're not going to be there for a very long time. So the cases that we developed were, how do you engage that patient to get the information that you need? And it was guided by our faculty. And we were fortunate because we had faculty that in their clinical practice, things turned into telehealth. And in very much the same way, they were able to come into the sessions and the students would go in. And so their simulation prepared them to kind of have those encounters where they would watch with the faculty and then they would interact. So it was really it took the learning to a whole different level of how do you communicate and how do you, you know, you're sitting on your hands, you can't touch the patient, you can't feel, but you have to be able to use these other modes of communication. So we were able to quickly build it in, and we've been doing it since the beginning of COVID, and the higher level students are really enjoying that because I think they're really going to need that when they go into practice because it's going to be here to stay.
I think the fact that you can't examine a patient and you can't, you know, touch them in a telehealth visit really emphasizes the importance of the history taking and the communication that you have with patients. It's something that exists in the clinic or in the practice as well, but it really exaggerates how important it is to pick up the nonverbal cues. I don't know how that person did it. You know, it's hard when you don't have a picture, but nonverbal cues and also probing and really getting information from the patient. From the patient's perspective in terms of the history, really important.
Yeah.
One of the things I've noticed, you know, the first sort of telehealth facility I did was at the University of Virginia, and it was probably about 10 years ago now. And, you know, there were whole sophisticated environments dedicated to telehealth with high fidelity cameras and screens and so forth. And now, you know, a lot of it can be really dealt with on your phone, you know, which it's in the palm of your hand. And I think to Kristen's point a minute ago, obviously you don't have the ability to examine the patient firsthand or take the vitals. But I do think there's this emerging area of technology, you know, wearable medical technology, call it the Fitbit or the Apple Watch, that I think just as many of you have said, we're accelerating due to the pandemic, I think technology is going to really accelerate there. And there may be a way to start to tie those into the telehealth visits. So from our perspective, we're still putting in the technology that's needed. It's just not as dedicated as it used to be. It's much more flexible.
Thanks, Paul. We've just got a question in the chat, which I'm sure will keep us sort of occupied for quite a bit of period of time. And I'm sure, and it's one you're dealing with and one we have dealt with. So everyone's aware of the increasing prevalence of the open office environment and the controversy around that. There are often many demonstrative benefits through to, you know, some people actually seeing where their office is as a measure of value and importance. And this is really very challenging. And now in the midst of this current environment, we add this perspective of infection control. And also as we try and create more flexibility in the workplace, lower utilization and potentially times where space is not optimally utilized. So Paul, can I maybe as the design expert and also the person who's had to kind of weather the conversation of the benefits and burdens of open planning, I'd be really interested in your comments, and then we'll open it up for discussion.
Well, thank you, Tris. It's actually a really interesting question, and I think every organization's facing it right now. Like, what happens to office space post-pandemic when we can come back? Because I don't think everyone wants to come back. But the sort of ironic thing is, as Trish mentioned, we were really working with Johns Hopkins to figure out, is there a new model for the faculty office? And where we got to was, let's have 12 people volunteer to give up their private offices and move into a specially designed suite. So what we looked at here and in other locations was more of a workstation model. But think of it, I think someone on the team had coined the term the quiet rail car, right? So there's it has a door on it. There's a suite of 12 people. They're in open office environment and it's controlled. However, they also get the benefit of having a small cafe environment to work in. They can reserve a private office for a day or 2 days or an hour, whatever they need. And they have their own, all these amenities, and they have this social, let's call it sort of loose furniture approach, where they could sit in a soft chair and use a laptop. These are all things that we tried to do to kind of provide this new environment. How it works, I don't know. It's sort of an experiment that I'm really interested in following, but I think we got it right. And I think the pandemic's going to actually encourage more of this to occur.
Thanks, Paul. You'll be very excited to see, you know, in our new building pictured behind me, our air conditioning is all compliant, which is a very big relief. But I'll just really open it up for conversation. And I'm sure, Anne, you're dealing with this conversation. Judy, you will have. I've dealt with conversations with faculty who still want an office in the School of Nursing and one in the School of Medicine. And, you know, those things are just not, it's just not the way of the world. So as leaders, I'd be really interested in how you're approaching it at your institutions.
Well, thank you. I'll take first try at this. We are in conversations with faculty and with staff. It is very mixed. As Paul said, some people don't want to come back, don't feel safe coming back. And certainly if there was not the possibility of social distancing while in their workspace, would feel uncomfortable doing that. Many have discovered that they can be much more productive from home, data management or working on research. It's that missing the opportunity to be with colleagues and be with students that will pull people back eventually. But we're probably going to settle into 3 days a week, 2 days a week, and alternate when folks are on campus so that they have a little bit of both. But that's not ideal either. So still very, very much in conversation, and just bringing the students back and needing social distancing is fraught issues because we do not have the classrooms to social distance the numbers of students that we will have in a classroom. So there'll have to be a mixture there as well, but definitely ongoing conversations.
Yeah, I'll echo that. And I think there will be, it will be evolving. The solutions will be evolving as we try things out and they work or don't work. Our building, all of the faculty have very small, same size offices. And we had enough offices pretty much to give everybody their own space. And in some cases, a shared office. So I don't know that the faculty offices will be, what we'll be doing with that, but we're having a bottom-up solution. We have a committee for the reimagined workspace. We're really looking in terms of the fall and not the summer. The summer we're going to probably stay pretty much the way we are. And we're asking staff and faculty bottom up, what are the best practices? What are other places doing? What do you want? How could we work it out together? We're not mandating any. We're being very flexible about people's needs. And like what was said, some people have more higher fear level than others. The students will be back, and we have been back with students. So it's not like we've been completely removed. Our students have been in simulation and in clinical since last summer. So there've been, you know, faculty around. And then I think we may do some hotel type things for the staff because our staff space is completely open and there are no windows that open up. Now, I don't care how good the air conditioning is. I think people mentality-wise want to see an open window so that fresh air can come in, even if the circulating air is already purified. So it's going to be evolving, and I think everyone's just going to have to be open-minded and flexible. It's going to be a test for all of us.
Thanks so much. Jennifer, can I ask you?
Yeah, I just wanted to add, I think it's been interesting. I had a couple staff who started either right before the pandemic hit or after. And I would say one of the things that we have found most difficult is that people are highly productive at home, but what's missing is what is the culture? What is the tone and tenor of the school? How do things move? How do you get to know people that you're not sitting in Zoom meetings with? So I think people have enjoyed the flexibility and would like to keep that, even if we're back to a place where people feel safe with their own health in returning. But at the same time, I think there is something to be said about sort of the culture of an organization. How do we share that when we might only have a third of the people in the building at any one time, or a half? I think some of the spaces that Paul was speaking about, those are going to take on even more prominence, because there's going to need to be that need to get to know people. And I'm sure many of you, I've been on many, many calls for the last year, but what I miss is the conversation on the way to get to the cup of coffee that, oh, I didn't know this was happening, or, oh, that's it. And plus it also creates sort of that, I know you as a person, not just your role in the school, that I think helps make an organization run well too. So I think it's going to be an interesting combination as we move forward.
Thanks so much, Jennifer. And I think one of the tensions that I guess we're all peer schools, you know, highly ranked schools in academic health science centers, and students come to the university for those academic clinical partnerships. They come to meet with faculty. They come to relate with their peers. I read a really great comment the other day about setting up in thoughtful and intentional neural connections. Like, how do we make it worth someone's while to commute an hour and a half? And also, how do we, for our students, make sure that they're getting this academic health science environment experience? I don't know if anyone has any comments and hopefully some solutions that we can all learn from. And maybe while you're thinking, Emerald, can I ask you, you know, you have been juggling a very challenging program, a DMP, PhD, not for the faint-hearted. What are some of your learnings from this time and some of the things that we should be thinking about from the student perspective?
Thank you for asking me this question. I think there are so many things to think about. One, I've actually been able to do better with balancing time amidst this pandemic in the DMP PhD program. Point in case, literally right now, I am dressed in full clinical garb. I just left clinical today. I didn't have to drive somewhere to go to a meeting. And I was able to talk to everyone who is in this meeting right now as a result of it. So that's one of the, yes, it has been a challenge in the pandemic, but that's also been a great plus. And then also for the PhD, so that is for the DMP side of things, but for the PhD side, the research portion, there is a challenge when you are recruiting participants who should be in person, and you're changing the research to maybe meet someone outside their door and drop off the portions of the research for the study. The interaction is not the same, but I've been making a lot of great phone calls with family members in my research study. So there's so much balancing that happens, but the great thing is that the balancing sometimes just happens right here, right on the computer. I'm able to do so many different things as well as form meaningful interactions with people through the program. So I think in some ways it actually has benefited me, even though it's a horrible thing that has happened.
Thanks for those comments, Emerald. This is, you know, the aim of this conversation. We want to take the good things and move forward and leave all the bad things and the COVID behind. Just for people are maybe thinking about how we can create opportunities, vibrant opportunities for our students. Another question that's come in that has come up in several themes is, what are the trends on the horizon for the future of nursing education and evolving pedagogy, particularly in the context of interprofessional education, social determinants of health, dealing with the overt examples of structural racism? And also, a lot of what we're experiencing in society, particularly widening health disparities in the context of COVID-19. So Anne, if I could put you on the spot, because I think this is something that you are thinking about in your building, and one that we tried in our building is to be more open to the community, not sort of a concrete bunker.
Yes, absolutely. We are looking at those community connections. And we're also adding content related to global awareness. And we just really need to focus on population health in the curriculum. We've seen a real uptick in the number of students or applicants who are interested in population health now. This is an opportunity for the nursing profession to really showcase what nurses can do in keeping populations healthy. The focus on anti-racism is something that I'm very proud that our school is undertaking the development or the establishment of a Center for Anti-Racism in Nursing. We know and acknowledge that this is an urgent need, and we need to move forward with the doing something rather than just talking about it. Social determinants of health, interprofessional education, those opportunities for students to connect outside of the classroom are very important when you're building a new building. So those are the three main content areas that we're really placing a focus on.
I'd like to add to that. I think, you know, as nurses, we don't work in a silo. We know that when we finish our education, we are working as a team. And I think we've made leaps and bounds over the years to really make sure that we're educating nurses to not be in a silo and to learn early on to work as a team. And it's amazing to see from when I was in nursing school and to what we're doing now, that interprofessional education. And this kind of goes with the whole conversation of this, like, you know, whether we wanted to or not, we all underwent a digital transformation. And so during that, how do you then keep the connections? How do you do the interprofessional educations? And there's some sense, like Emerald was saying, that some people feel more, you know, more productive, more involved, but you're losing that interconnectivity of that personal contact. But I do feel like it further allows us to maybe collaborate more than we have. You're able to have meetings that maybe you weren't able to have. You would go to maybe the School of Engineering, you make a day out of it, but now you're inviting more people to the table. And I see in a lot of the events that we're having, people from a whole different background. And I think that's important when you're moving forward. And if you want to continue to have that digital transformation, you have to have a diverse team, can't work in silos. You know, part of our work in education is, you know, I focus on advanced practice a good bit, but advanced practice needs to communicate with nurses and they need to communicate with the team. And so we're starting to really recognize putting them together in simulations and in experiences so they can learn how to communicate early on. And we're using right now virtual reality to do multiplayer virtual reality, where they can actually communicate in the virtual reality or the screen base together and they could be across the world. So it's really, I think it's in looking at the positive, looking at the digital transformation. Yes, we've had barriers, but now it's opened doors and we're going to be able to reach people at a global level that maybe we weren't able to before. So I think within our school of nursing, even just looking at the space, and Paul brought up really good points about rooms that can transform into multi-purpose rooms. And I think that's where we're heading in the future. We need to be able to convert it to maybe it's a sim room one day, maybe we're doing procedures next, maybe we're meeting in there, or maybe you're doing some, you know, you're all over the place doing different virtual meetings, and that's okay, whether you're at home or you're in your office space. So I think, you know, we have to look at this and take it as an exciting time and embrace this kind of digital revolution. But we have to continue to push it and make sure that we're working together across the silos within our schools and outside.
You are so right that those planned activities have to be planned. I love looking at this as an opportunity. So kudos to you for bringing that forward. It does make it easier to bring people from different disciplines together in the same room. So thank you.
And I have to just add that I think the COVID pandemic, followed shortly by the racial pandemic, They really sort of synergistically work together. And it became very obvious on our academic health center that we shared a lot of similar concerns, similar needs in educating our future health professionals to be anti-racist in the way they deliver care and to deliver health equitable care. And so we share a lot, and that was like a great platform. And we've had many, many committees that are collaborating across the medical health center. And we've established friendships, we've established professional relationships, and they're persisting, even though the COVID crisis is really simmering down a bit. So I think there were just a lot of things that were fired by what's happening. And I think that fire has stimulated some very, very good work. We have a lot of work to do. In many ways, our students are way ahead of us on a lot of these issues, on health disparities, health equity, but we're all working towards it.
Thanks. And I should really also acknowledge another really vital part of the school ecosystem is our digital support. And I just want to thank Rafe and Florentina behind the scenes making this happen. So it's identified another really vital part of the school. But Paul, could I maybe just ask you to summarize what are some of the design principles that we have to think about to promote connectivity and collaboration in buildings? And we can maybe do this without sort of a whole new building.
Yeah, that's a really good point. And you know, it's asked of us all the time. It's like, how do you create that strong academic community? And it's not just the students, right? It's the researchers, it's the faculty, it's the staff members. And I think there are simple things you can do with space. Sometimes it's just furnishings. Sometimes it's just, you know, you have a lobby, you have a corridor space that's a little bit wider. How can you create maybe a booth where people can collaborate on their laptop or just face-to-face over a cup of coffee? I think paying attention to the space outside of the classrooms, outside of the sim labs is really, really important. You know, how do you deal with exterior space? Is there space near your building where that could be used to collaborate or to, you know, just build that synergy, build that connectedness, the belongingness? All of those things are really important. I do just want to say, if I can diverge slightly back to the technology piece, because I think, you know, we're talking a lot of, there's a lot of optimism on this web conference, and it's about kind of how the pandemic has pushed us, right? And I was thinking about that, like every patient, every student, every faculty member had a pivot to technology. And you know, technology was already booming, and AI is poised to get really big, as well as AR and VR in the next 5 years. So making sure buildings have spaces, and was Kristen was speaking, you know, we're doing a number of these, what we call white box spaces. They're almost like black box theaters where you can set up big simulations, or you could set it up as a study area, you could set it up as an event space. I think those things are also ways of establishing and creating community amongst your schools.
Thanks, Paul. The time has gone really quickly, so I'm going to ask each of the panelists to leave us with some thoughts relating from the discussion, but also maybe even more important is what are some of the questions that we should be asking as we move forward. And, you know, Paul, when you were speaking, I wrote myself a note, you know, what is the water cooler of the future? You know, how are we going to look at this? So I'm going to ask each of our panelists to leave us with some thoughts. And Emerald, I thought you would start with you to maybe leave us with some thoughts about, you know, what should the dean be thinking about in planning a school of the future?
Okay, so one of the things that I thought about immediately, I recently, as a result of the pandemic, was able to work with people around the globe on a paper about dismantling racism.
and in education specifically. And we talked about different things that need to happen in the future. And I'm just going to mention those four things because I think that that is a great place to start. So the first one was that learning resources must reflect multiple ethnicities to account for differences and similarities in assessment and diagnosis. I think that's one change for nursing. A second one is that there needs to be a higher degree. Nursing and midwifery researchers should not teach students to merely control for race when health disparities such as health access are pivotal in the burden of disease. The third is race must be challenged as an unproblematic risk factor for disease and course material. Clearer reflection needs to show the impact and subsequent weathering on health status. And then the last one is to increase visibility and influence of BAME and BIPOC faculty in academia and leadership to continually counter the effects of colonialism and racism. So those are the four things that I think.
Well, thanks so much, Emerald. And one of the things that I'm really proud of is in our new building, in our courtyard, we have an acknowledgement of country on the wall, led by one of our Native American faculty, Teresa Brockie and colleagues. And I think it's a very bold statement of the values of the school. So thanks so much, Emerald. And maybe Jennifer, can I ask you to leave us with some thoughts?
So I wanted to speak, I think Emerald did, from her research, but also from the student perspective. As some of the faculty mentioned, students many times are coming to us already far more engaged and involved in this, these topics, whether it's technology, whether it's racism, a variety of different issues. And I think really working with them, understanding how the pandemic and the racial unrest has affected them, and really learning from them. What do we take away that's positive? How do we make changes? How do we move forward? And to really embrace that. I think many times in academia, it's scary to give up that knowledge piece that the students in some arenas might know more than the faculty member. But I think that I think it's not a giving up, it's an embracing of this is a world and we all need to learn from each other. And you have experienced things by virtue of your age or where you've lived or a variety of different places that you've come from that really can help us all as an organization and as a nursing profession move forward. So I would very much think that we really need to ask and work with our students very closely after this time period.
Thanks so much, Jennifer. And also I think one thing that if I could add is that you no longer are schools built around faculty. They need to be built around staff, students, and the community as well. Kristen.
So I think, everybody is bringing up some really great points and kind of jumping off of that. I think, I've read this recently that, technology alone isn't enough to make an organization successful. And we know that. And we're all using and embracing technology. And I think it's exciting and we need to, but there's more to it. I think the key questions, I think, for moving forward and what we need to ask as educators and how do we make any of these learning opportunities, immersive learning opportunities, how do we make them more learner-centered? And how do we deliver, you think about precision medicine. Well, what about precision learning? There is all this data that we're collecting. We're going to be using data. How do you then use that data to really tailor what the needs of the student are? Gone are the days of someone sitting behind, a podium and lecturing. And no one was ever really designed to learn like that. We're all adult learners. We like multimodal learning and we need to embrace digital technology to do this. But I think we have to continue to remind ourselves, how do we implement immersive learning that will change behavior? And so again, everybody wants to check all the cool creative technology boxes, but you don't want to get caught up in that. You want to make sure that there's a change in behavior. My next question is, how do you reach a global audience? How do you continue to push as educators to reach a global audience outside? We have the opportunity now, and so we have to be able to do that. And my last thing is, how do we push ourselves to continue to work outside of silos? We want to have unbound collaboration. And I think it's important, and what I'm finding and thinking about diversity, equity, inclusion, you know, we have a great committee that's there at the school now. And I think as we're planning and as we're implementing things, there should be representatives from each one of those groups at the table. And so when you're planning or thinking about things, those things are thought about at the beginning and not as an afterthought. So I do think that's an important component that we need to think about, whether it's a silo within the place we're working or don't work out in the silo with our other professions.
Thanks so much, Kristen. Judy.
Yeah, I think there are just some key words. I really can't put them in a question, but I think we have to keep what worked well and go forward with that, number one. And I don't think, I think we have to decide what worked well, and that has to be through some real data. I would encourage people to really think about innovating in the future and not be doing what they've done before, sort of reverting back, like, can we fit the square peg that we were in this now round hole where we're going? I think you really have to think, push the boundaries and just allow yourself to be innovative as an educator. And I would put that same onus on the students. Our students, you know, when you were talking, Jennifer, about the students that we have now, it makes me very happy that the face of nursing is the face that you described. It's a sophisticated, well-educated, socially conscious individual, and that's who we want to drive the healthcare system. And I think they will be taking a lead, and I think we have to make those, we have to help them to be those leaders and take care of us in the future. And then I also encourage people just to be uncomfortable, because if you're a little uncomfortable, that means that something's not right and you've got to change something. You may not know exactly what it is, but that discomfort does drive you in a direction to do something productive. You know, this has been a terrible year, but I do think there are kernels of a really special kernels that we have to hold on to and move forward with. And I'm very encouraged that we'll do a good job with that.
Thanks so much, Judy, for those wise and very inspirational words. Anne, you're on mute. Sorry.
Myself. Building on what all of the wise minds in the room have already said, we as a profession need to change our pace of innovation. Traditionally, not just nursing, but all of health sciences have really exhibited considerable inertia when it comes to new technologies and new techniques. We don't like being uncomfortable. We need to change that. And we need to change our worldview to become early adopters, innovators, and creators. I'll leave with that.
Thanks so much, Anne. And Paul, we'll close with you. I'd be just really interested to hear, as you're looking to create innovative learning spaces for the future, what do you think are some of the issues we should be thinking about?
Well, I want to kind of relate to Judy's comments. I think really thinking outside the box is the way you have to go, because, you know, think about what everybody is doing and needs to do. Things like makerspaces or technology test labs or exercise areas where you can do yoga, you know, these super flexible immersive spaces. But more importantly, I think there's also an acknowledgement, and it's been underscored by the pandemic, that nurses, you know, they are the glue, you know, that holds healthcare together. And they've been under enormous stress. So buildings can help build nursing, you know, resiliency, help them have restorative spaces, wellness. We got to think about the whole student, faculty, and researcher, not just the learning space.
Great. Well, thanks so much, everybody. We're at the top of the hour. This has been a really rich and vibrant discussion, certainly given us a lot of food for thought. For people who are on Facebook Live, please follow the Twitter handles from University of Washington, Columbia University, Hord, Coplan, Macht, and Johns Hopkins School of Nursing. Because over the next few days, we'll be distilling some of the key messages from this Facebook Live. And also, please share your ideas and views. Together, we're stronger. That's one thing this pandemic has taught us. And my sincere thanks to my colleagues here today, and in particular, to the University of Washington and Columbia for joining us in this conversation. And thanks so much to Hord, Coplan, Mott. The beautiful building behind me is just breathtaking, and I hope it inspires the future generation and is also catalytic in the recovery and adjustment that we all need to experience after these very tough times. So thank you very much, everybody.